Hi, my name is Isabel, and I work for the European Parliament in the Spanish booth. I've been doing this for almost 20 years, 18 years this month, and I started off as a freelancer and then became a temporary agent, and I'm now a staff member. But everything I say today is obviously my own opinion. The subject I'm going to try to cover briefly is the issue of meeting preparation. Now, it's very difficult to define meeting preparation. I think I'm going to try to define it by what it is not, or at least by what it is not just. We had a tendency, at least in when I did my training in interpreting, to concentrate on generating glossaries. Well, meeting preparation is not just glossaries. Glossaries are very important. They give you access to important vocabulary that will come up in the meeting, especially when they're on a very specific subject matter. You definitely need to know all of that, and you definitely need to prepare all of that. But it is never enough. Knowing the vocabulary, even if there were exact equivalents for every single word, which there aren't, knowing the vocabulary is not enough. Interpreting is not about words as such. It is about a message that you need to get across. And we all know, for example, the difference between using a glossary that you've done yourself and using a glossary that somebody has just given to you. The second example is a lot less useful. It can be useful, but it's a lot more useful to do it yourself. The reason being, you will have gone through the documentation in very different languages. You will have been looking up information. Will have been finding possible equivalents and selecting them. And all that process is part of the meeting preparation, even if it's not reflected on the piece of paper or the archive that you decide is going to be your glossary. So it's definitely not just glossaries. And in a way, in the era of ubiquitous internet, the importance of glossaries, I think, has reduced somewhat. When there was no internet in the booth, like when I started, glossaries were indeed very important, and dictionaries and paper dictionaries were very, very important because very often it was the only source. But now you can, at the click of a button, find words really fast by doing a search in a search engine or in any other sort of online tool. And I think that's one of the reasons glossaries are less important, but other things, the kind of things that will allow you to do the right search at the right time and find the right answer, have become in a way more important. And that's what I want to talk about today. Another thing that meeting preparation is very much not just, is not just about the meeting documents that they have given to you for a specific meeting. We should always go beyond that. Sometimes because there are too many documents and it's impossible to go into them in the time that you have available when they arrive late, and many of them are long and complex. So you need to know how to go into that and select what you're going to do to prepare and not just blindly try to read everything. That was a mistake I made when I was starting, but over time one learns how to select and how to select the right things in the right order, especially when time is limited and especially when you're working with different languages and with different problems depending on the language. But it's also not just the documents that you're provided with when there are not enough. Very often you would just have an agenda. Sometimes you would, have the temptation to just read the documents that they give you and say, there's nothing else, I've done my job, I read everything they gave me. No, definitely not. Precisely because we have search engines available everywhere, there is no excuse not to type stuff in at any time before the meeting, even at the start of the meeting, even during the meeting. For example, if a colleague has a problem with some concept, and find out stuff about what's going on that will allow you to understand the issues that are being talked about and do a better job. The European Parliament is a very good example for this because subjects tend to come up again and again in different stages of the legislative procedure in different ways over a relatively long period of time. The whole procedure starts in a committee and then it will go through the groups in different ways. There'll be shadow meetings, they'll go back to committee, it'll go back to the groups, and it'll eventually end up in plenary. And I remember when I was starting as a freelance, I would come every so often to Parliament, but not very often. And I would often, for some reason, get put in group meetings, which I hated because there was no documentation. at all. What you got was on paper and very last minute. And remember, there was no Wi-Fi then. So there was no way that you could cover that. And then when I started as a temporary agent, I realized how much easier it got, because more often than not, I would have heard of many of these issues, if not all, previously in the previous stages of the legislative procedure, where they did have the reports or the draft reports available to you in the booth. And that knowledge always helped. So you should never try to empty your brain at the end of a meeting of whatever was interesting and useful in the meeting. You can get away with forgetting the technical terms, because you can always look them up after. But if you understand the issues, the problems at stake, the different positions that are being configured, the conflicts, the way that some sort of consensus is being built, that kind of information, which is very intangible, is what will be useful to you at every single further stage of the procedure. And I also remember at that time, after a year or so, suddenly plenary sessions became a lot easier, because it was never the case anymore that I would get put on a shift where I hadn't heard of any subject. It is very rare these days that I do a plenary shift where I've never heard of anything. Most of the time I've heard of every point, if not all, most of the points, in different ways. It can be through the documents from other meetings and through the issues and the debates from other meetings, indeed, as I just explained. But it can also, and will often be, just through stuff that I've learned over time. Meeting preparation is, again, not just about official documents, not even of the meeting you're in, but of any meeting. There can be debates where no document is provided, in plenary or elsewhere, and that will force you to try and find as much information about the issues at stake in another matter. And there, again, the internet will help, especially if you're very good at searching properly and finding what you need as fast as possible, and with the least waste of time possible, because that's one of the dangers, especially at a time where information is everywhere and there's so much. You can do a lot of preparation and do it wrong, in the sense that it won't be useful at all for the meeting you're doing. And that also you learn over time by doing many debates wherever you happen to work, and by understanding how things are treated and how stuff is debated, you will get better and better at doing your searches as specifically and as focused as possible, which will then help you be more rested and do a better job, which is, of course, the goal. So it goes well beyond all of that. It also goes beyond anything you might do for a specific meeting. You know, I will have looked up a subject for yesterday's plenary or not. Sometimes the preparation, say for yesterday's plenary, this was the case, I'd already done the preparation, it turned out. When I looked at the agenda, there were subjects that I knew enough of that I could just try to bring them up to the top of my brain, and that was basically enough. So it felt like I hadn't done any preparation, because I did not sit for 3 hours and try to work out in things what they were going to be talking about, but actually I had. I'd done it over a very long space of time. In fact, probably, well, most of my career. The things that you know and the things that you understand and the issues that you get there evolve over time. And that's part of the fun and of the accuracy of the job. The more you learn and the more you keep preparing at any point, the better you do your job and the more rewarding it'll be to do your job. Another thing is it's not just about reading preparation. We tend to find our information on our sources of general knowledge and specific knowledge online, that's mostly read, or in other sorts of publications, social media, etc. That's all very well, but you can get into trouble with that. Not long ago, we were talking about the Uyghur community in China, and the word came out of context. It was just, let's talk about the problem with the Uyghur. And it threw us completely in the booth. And when we realized what it was about, it felt so stupid that we had never heard the word. We hadn't gone and tried to find online, it's there, how this word is pronounced in English. It is written more or less in the same way in every language. The Spanish pronunciation is completely different. I had read a lot in English about the subject. When I heard it pronounced, it threw me completely. So I would urge to compliment, if nothing else, any reading that is done by listening to the radio, listening to podcasts, listening to anything that is live and natural speech is very, very useful. Because, well, this kind of thing can and will happen to you. It can happen. You don't know when, but the more you read and the more you listen, the better prepared you will be for your meeting. And another thing is it's not really about knowing even. It's not really about knowledge. There's a lot of things we need to know. General knowledge is essential. But an infinite curiosity is also essential. This is what we were told at the beginning of the interpreting studies. And I think it's something we tend to forget once we get into the job. And I think that's very sad and wrong. An interpreter is also defined by an infinite curiosity for all sorts of things. And it's a very interesting infinite curiosity because the way I know things or I know about things is very different from the way my brother who works in IT or any of my friends who are actually specialists in different things know about their own things. I know things without really knowing them, but I know enough about them that it will be helpful for me in the booth to grasp the issues and know what to look out for, and that I will be able to look for the information that's missing that I've forgotten because the interpreter brain can't really keep too much information at once, but it can identify the turning points and the issues and the moments where a specific thing needs to be looked up. An example of this is the pair Somalia-Somaliland. I remember I was in a meeting about Somalia. The whole of the agenda just said Somalia, and suddenly they started talking about Somaliland. It is very difficult to hear if you're not primed to look out for whether they say one thing or they're saying the other. I know there is a difference between Somalia and Somaliland. I could not for the life of me explain to you exactly what it is right now. But if I have a meeting about the subject in 10 minutes, I will search it. I will look it up. I'll know to look out for that difference when listening. And I'll know that the two are very different and that should never, never be confused. And that's already enough, in a way, enough knowledge for an interpreter to then do a good job once in the meeting. So it never ends, you know, it never ends. It's an effort that lasts your whole career, your whole life. You have to have the curiosity as a basis. It has to be part of your life. I've been reading a weekly source and weekly magazine for probably 18 years, 20 years probably now, and I read it for pleasure. This is part of what I do on a weekend. And I will also select the articles completely based on what I feel like reading and not based on what I think will be useful. Because that's part of the fun. And then it is, in the end, useful. I remember the whole of the economic crisis was a time when a lot of financial acronyms and concepts and vocabulary came up in meetings. And this we were battling with this because it's a very difficult subject and it's very complicated and intricate. And I have been reading this weekly for years, at this point probably 15 years. And I remember it was in a meeting of the economic committee and I was just as lost with the acronyms and with the words. And I was just as needing to look things up and to concentrate really well on what I was doing. But I suddenly understood what the issue was. After many, many years of meetings in the economics affairs committee, I suddenly understood what it was about. Thanks to, I realized at that moment, 15 years of reading the finance section and trying to work out what the economic crisis was really about. And the difference between the words and this knowledge is enormous, but they're both necessary to do the best job possible when you're in the booth. And I would also like to finish, we don't have much time, I don't want to go into much more detail, but I'm not particularly interested in finance. I did read all the articles on finance because I wanted to understand what the world was doing, but you should never forget to read and to learn and to keep evolving all your knowledge on the things that you like as well. That's part of the rewarding experience of being an interpreter, and the more you like a subject, the more it'll stay in your mind, and the more you will then be able to contribute to your interpreting team with that very deep knowledge when it does come up. And it will come up, because everything and anything can come up definitely in the European Parliament, and I think in the interpreting profession, which is so varied, probably as well. Well, I hope this was interesting, and not just for people who work for the European Parliament, maybe others can find some elements of usefulness in it as well. Thank you.